Okay. Henry Hobson Richardson, 1838, 1886. He died young at 48. Yet he became one of the most important architects who brought modernism somehow to the United States. And together with Louis Sullivan and Frank Lloyd Wright, they are considered the recognized trinity of American architecture. So Henry Hobson Richardson, born on the 29th of September, 1838, was a preeminent American architect, best known for his work in a style that became known as Richardsonian Romanesque. Along with Louis Sullivan and Frank Lloyd Wright, as I said, Richardson is one of the recognized trinity of American architecture. Here was the man, and again, it's said that he died rather young, and yet he built a lot. And I can only imagine what he would have built if he lived for 40 years more, but he didn't. I like this very much, this picture of him, you know, kind of like almost like a, if I am to express myself oxymoronically, well, he looks a little bit like a monk. But maybe a sensual monk, you know, a secular monk, if I am to use an oxymoron. Anyway, an interesting man, and he does look like an interesting man, and I like him. And I think his architecture was remarkable, and there is much to learn from it. And also what is interesting about Richardson is that when most people inspire themselves from the Renaissance and even rarely from the Gothic, he inspired himself from the Romanesque. This was almost unique. And I imagine that if he lived longer, he would have brought to being some very interesting buildings. But even until 48, he did a lot. So yes, happy birthday, Mr. Richardson. Yes, he does look like a man with a will, and he did have a will, but I think he was also a sensitive man. And we need examples like him, I think. All of us, in a way, because if we are to inspire by something, what else could inspire us better than the examples and the professional cultural trajectories of someone like him? Okay, we begin with this very famous work by him, and it's famous enough. It was famous enough to make it to the hardcover or the cover pages of the modern architecture volume of the World History, the History of World Architecture in 18 volumes, the one on modern architecture written by Tafuri and Francesco Dalco. The cover of the book is represents exactly this church by Richardson, the Trinity Church. I show some images from various works at the beginning, and then later on we develop a more careful or attentive or detailed presentation of the work. So, you know, 1870s or so, H.H. Richardson, Boston. And yes, you would say it's a historicist building, and in a way it is. But it still has, it is coherent architecturally. It has a certain complexity. It has even some inventions. It's well kept under control, so to speak. And it does belong, when you look at it, it does belong to the 19th century. Somehow it's not totally devoid of a certain certain modernism. I'm saying something a little bit risky here, because at the first sight you would say this is a traditionalist building, whatever the word traditionalist means. But there is the verve, the vivacity of the building, and a certain hybridity, aesthetical hybridity, which I think qualifies it to be considered, at least in part, not idiosyncratic, but a little bit. I mean, there are innovations here, and it's an original work. Although, at the first sight, you'd say this is, it's a building inspired by the past, and it is inspired. But he didn't remain there at the level of just applying the inspiration ad literam to his present, meaning 1870s. Now, the Thomas Crane Public Library in Quincy, Massachusetts, with a Japanese-inspired eyelid, with Japanese-inspired eyelid dormers in the roof on each side of the entrance. So this is a library. In his case, some buildings are libraries, some buildings are maybe, like a city hall or other kind of function, but they do look similar. This might be sometimes a little bit questionable, a little bit, but I still think the building has it's convincing. It has force and even grace at times. The old Colony Station in northeastern Massachusetts illustrate Richardson's use of Japanese architectural concept. This is a railway station. He built several railway stations. What exactly the Japanese influence is and to what extent the Japanese influence could be applied to a railway station is to be discussed. Interestingly, both Frank Lloyd Wright and Richardson had influence from the East, from Japan. Not so much Sullivan, as far as I know. A detail from the old Colony railroad station showing a dragon carved in the beam of a glazed Syrian arch. And here it is. Of course, such things do not interest us today because we think ornament should be totally banished, and so should a narrative architecture, which I think is not the case. But although built in traditional fashion of stone without steel frame, Richardson well integrated Marshall Field wholesale store in Chicago was very influential in the development of modern approaches to building facades. A huge building expressing the conquest of the land by the European colonists in a way, they transformed very quickly the land of the United States into proclamation of victory from the white man, all these huge buildings. After all, what is the function of this building? It's a wholesale store, it's about selling and buying, about being merchants. This is the ethos of capitalism, to sell and buy, to produce and to consume, But the building is powerful, in the Renaissance, if you had such a building built, it would have been considered, one of the masterpieces. Here is just one work by H. H. Richardson, one between others. Howard Taylor Library building in New Orleans, constructed at the end of the 19th century. not very dissimilar from the building we saw earlier, also a library. He was, Richardson believed in the wall, in the solid, rigid wall, and in opacity in a way. But he also has windows. I think he was a very, very skillful architect, you know, and this kind of architecture, you know, very, very massive, you know, fortress-like, was his trademark. The John Glessner House in Chicago, 1986 is wrong. It should be 1886, sorry. Here it is, fortress-like itself. Yeah, he brought to North America, well, he was born there, but he brought to the culture of North America, the architectonic culture, stone wall, which not too many architects used. So there is this rawness in his architecture, which I think is a quality. Grange Sartre Junior House in Albany, New York, 1882. I almost said squeezed between the other buildings, between this one and this one. So this is the building. I see an announcement here when the picture was taken. Who knows? Maybe, well, they were renting an apartment or something here. A mansion. With a postcard from 1900s, but this was not built in the United States, but in Great Britain. And I like this building. It's just that it was demolished. There is just one fragment that is still standing. It's a building that was built on a sketch or an early project by H. Richardson. But I would say a very good building. We'll come back to it. I think the Cheney building in Hartford, Connecticut from 1905 on a postcard. I don't know if it still exists. Now the Grace Episcopal Church in Medford, Massachusetts, 1867. So it's an earlier work seen from above. He built several churches. The truth is the North Americans, despite the well-known pragmatism and mercantilism, built a lot of churches. I don't think there is a country in the world with as many churches as the United States has. Only Brooklyn, New York has 11,000 churches. I still don't believe this number, but I remember I read about this. 11,000 churches just in Brooklyn? Could this be true? And look at this, you know, look at the exuberance of placing those stones in that way on the walls, you know. It's very, on one hand, kind of questionable because, you know, they're a little bit coming forward, so to speak, from the wall. But on the other hand, they seem to bring some kind of Dionysian turbulence on the wall of the church. You know, the wall becomes very animated because of those big stones that two days ago or so, I talked about the Palazzo built by Michelozzo in Florence with the big stones on the first floor. But I see that Richardson goes upwards with these stones all the way, even on the roof. Very interesting. It's not necessarily my most preferred form of aesthetics, but it is unusual. Look at the stones, and I love the stones. You know, they I think they are beautiful. Almost it doesn't matter how they are, you know, put to work. I think we need more stones in our works, but I guess stones are not so easy to find any longer, or considering the amount of buildings we build, we certainly don't have a lot of stone for all of them. But here H.H. Richardson in the 19th century indulged, and I imagine he liked the tectonics, you know, derived from, you know, heaviness as opposed to lightness, like the avant-garde or the star architects of the present, particularly those from Japan. Know, from the school of Toyo Ito, Kazuyo Sejima, Ishigami, Su Fujimoto, they love lightness, you know, but here it's the very opposite. Heaviness and stone, heaviness and stone. It's a very interesting church in a way, you know, and look, stones all the way up on the spire. Rather unusual. Otherwise, you know, the building maybe is not very innovative, but there is something there still. The master expressed himself. The interior also, the structure of the woodwork is good. I hope I have a better picture here. No, unfortunately I don't, but you can still see a little bit at the top. The Benjamin Crowning Shield House in Boston, 1868. It's an apartment. Well, I'm sure there are several apartments here. A big house. But even you can see that even here there is an architect with personality. You know, he crafted his building maybe not dramatically differently from neighboring houses or buildings, but if you look more carefully at the building, you can tell that this is not just a mimicking architect. It's not an architect who, you know, has nothing to say. You know, unusual things, you know, they, you know, like this big chimney here right in the front elevation, you know, the mansard in a way, you know, it's interesting, it's cubical, it's almost, if I look at the building, I somehow see his face. I see him, I see his personality. And it's not one of his best buildings. It's not, but and built well. I mean, look at this. This is a 150 years old building. Maybe more, a little more than 150. And it's still, maybe it was refurbished, but it's still in good shape. Now his own house in Staten Island, this one was refurbished, was renovated, 1868. He built a lot, and we didn't yet see some other buildings by him. It's remarkable, by 48, he truly built a lot. Sorry about the resolution of these pictures. Interesting that although he usually liked especially walls on the lower levels of the buildings made of, you know, very fortress-like with the stones and so on, in his own house, the lower parts of the building are even, you know, at least the way we see the building now, very light and white, and it's almost like in opposition with what we saw before. The Alexander Dallas monument in 1868. This one is not so remarkable, perhaps, but we are going to see another one, which is very good. And I made this comment before, that very few architects today pay attention to the afterlife. But in the 19th century, it was very common. Louis Sullivan also designed, for the dead a few times, and significantly. The William Dorsheimer House in Buffalo, New York, 1868. Maybe in a certain way, Richardson was able to assume the urban fabric and the urban culture, aesthetical or otherwise, in a more maybe a little bit in less personal terms than Frank Lloyd Wright. I think he was able to negotiate with the urban culture in less provocative ways than Frank Lloyd Wright. And he also designed, these big houses which are not, were not destined just for one family, or maybe a very large one family or two or three families. So there is an ability I think he had to address both the private and the public dimensions of art, of architecture. And we are going to see not much later some remarkable buildings destined obviously to the public. Another church in Boston, 1869. Let us not forget, this was the 19th century, almost mid 19th century. So we cannot expect, the extravagances of modernism that happened in the 20th century. But still, I think, if we look at this, building in detail and also from far away, we see a building which I think sits well where it sits. And without it, perhaps the urban landscape would be less interesting and diverse. And it seems the ivy also likes the walls built by Richardson. He believed in gravity. This man didn't want to fly, he understood that one can fly even if one builds with stone. Well, maybe it's wrong what I said, because in that church that we just saw, where he went upwards with the rocks, with the stones, all the way to the roofing of the spire, there perhaps we could say he did want to fly. He did want to make the stone fly. But this architect, I think it would be interesting to make a comparison between him, his work, and much lighter works built almost around the same time. The New York State Asylum, look at this. You'll be surprised. 1869, so this was 150 years ago, a little more than 150 years ago. Look at this. Any city in Europe would be proud to have something like this. And this was, from 150 years ago in the United States. What you see here, of course, is not his work, it's a modern intervention. But the buildings are, vigorously convincing, even if perhaps not very innovative or so-called creative. But I am absolutely sure that nobody dislikes them, and that they have a power, a dignity that helps the city that it is in. Very much so. Albany, New York. Yesterday, I also showed images from Albany, New York, with a governmental center, the administrative center of the capital of the state of New York, built by Wallace Harrison. Here we have Richardson himself, not lowering the standard of or standards of good architecture. So it's not for nothing that this man was considered, is considered so highly, you know, one of the three, you know, the trinity of modern architecture in the founders, in a way, you know, of modern architecture in the United States. Even if you might consider from today's positioning oneself, this building being historicist and not truly modern, but it depends what we mean by modern, actually. Now, a courthouse in Springfield, Massachusetts, from 1871. And here, I think, again, you'll be surprised, because it's a very powerful architecture, very telluric, very heavy, very fortress-like, and yes, very probably inspired by the pre-Gothic times, that is Romanesque architecture. It's not this one, actually. It's the next one I'm going to show, or it's part of the same example. I think I'm anticipating it here. So this is a courthouse where in Springfield, Massachusetts. It's not this one. I described a building which is going to be a little bit later. This one is I don't know, I mean, the level of historicism perhaps is a little bit higher. A church from Springfield, again, Springfield, 1871, the North Congregational Church. And it's not a church I would dislike, no. It's this interest he had in heaviness, in robustness, that differentiates him from a lot of architecture that we see in the present. And, you know, and it's also because he used natural materials, you know, mainly stone. It's unusual a little bit for us because of that, you know. And strangely, for example, in New York, they didn't talk much about H.H. Richardson, as they didn't talk about Frank Lloyd Wright, because Europe was fascinated by Europeans, by, you know, more recently by Giuseppe Terani, or, you know, a whitish rationalist architecture, if not plainly white. This is something else. But you don't have to read any text to realize that this is a church. It is a church without any doubt. I think it testifies about the power of architecture to speak without words. And it does speak. I am a church. It's a good building. It's a good building. And I think it connects well with the buildings around, with the trees even. I mean, this was a man who died at 48. I mean, he built all these buildings until being 48. And we didn't yet see everything by him. Yes, he uses the arch, like in Romanesque architecture. He uses things he didn't invent, maybe a lot. But he articulated the volumes interestingly and powerfully and with skill. Even the interior is interesting. I hope I have another picture with a with a structure. I should develop this presentation. But even in this picture, you have an idea about the ingenuity, aesthetical ingenuity, and I'm sure structurally it functions very well at the top. A fine building. What else can I say? The Trinity Church, which we already saw a picture of in Boston, 1872, which is a national historic landmark. I don't know. I mean, is this building superior to this building? I don't know. I'm not sure. Here, historicism is more obvious, it's true, but it's more ornated also, you know, more decorative. I personally like more the previous one somehow. Anyway, but the interior I do like, it's true. It is the New World, it is the United States, but also has a solid visual culture behind it. And it's interesting, you know, if you look at the building here and then somehow you wouldn't think this interior belongs to the same building we saw from the outside. There's something joyous and almost folkish about it. It reminds me of, it makes me think of, painted wooden folk furniture or, interesting. Also the plan, you know, with the central space, which is seems to be square. Strangely, I'm thinking now of a building, the first building built by Otto Wagner in Budapest, actually, a synagogue. It seems to have some similarities, this building with that building by Otto Wagner in Budapest. H H Richardson. Without doubt, he was a skillful architect. I mean, the way he, it wasn't so easy to control the spatial reality and also the reality of the walls. The way he chose to, ornate them and the colors and so on. It wasn't easy. I think he did a good job. Maybe it's more the interior that attracts, the superlative appreciations that this building enjoys. Boston. It even made it to a stamp. So this is the Trinity Church in Boston by H.H. Richardson. Made 150 years ago. What a difference now between the glass facade of the office tower behind and the building in the front. Harmony through contrast. Now, the William Watts Sherman House in Rhode Island, 1874. He understood the sculptural qualities of a chimney, as you can see. I kind of like it more in this older picture. You also see, I mean, at that time it was the Victorian age in Great Britain, and you know, the arts and crafts movement. There seem to be some correspondence here. There are some possible relationships. Look at the windows here. It's a good building. I even if you are not romantically inclined, I think you appreciate it, and it's probably a very, very comfortable house, but it's not for proletarians, so we better move on. The interior also, you know, it's not for blue collar workers. Blue collar workers usually cannot afford an architect and cannot afford to build a house for themselves easily. Quite rich, no? I mean, this is not an architecture to leave you indifferent. Quite rich, and particularly in this picture, you know, if I am to compare him with Frank Lloyd Wright with his early works, and there is a house in Oak Park with a triangular, with a powerful, you know, triangle of the sloping roofing or roof. I don't truly think that Richardson was, you know, less good than Wright. No. Hayden Building, Boston, 1875. This is a building maybe, you know, a little bit less appealing. You know, so the urban context is a little bit less pure, or I don't know, advantages, but it shows again that he built all kinds of things, not small, but private houses, public buildings. This is a public building. Stone again, he loves stone, obviously, and I don't blame him. Now, this building in Hartford, 1875, in Connecticut, another, you know, large, massive urban fortress. Although the windows are not quite fortress-like, they are rather large, not just on the first and second floor, but also above. So this is, in a way, some modernistic gesture. The walls are massive, but there is also a lot of glass. So where we see the glass with such dimensions, we could say that we are approaching at least modernity. The more glass, the more modern. The New York State Capitol, Albany, New York. Look at this. You know, an important administrative building in the same city where Wallace Harrison built. And yeah, it's not maybe not very original, but if this building was in Amsterdam, it would have been one of the treasures of Amsterdam. It is in Albany, upstate New York. It's not even in New York. But again, if this was in Amsterdam, would have been quite celebrated and visited by many tourists. They built a lot, that's the truth. I mean, overnight almost, and now China is doing the same. They built a lot, the North Americans. This is just one architect we are talking about. And he did all these buildings until he was 48, unbelievable almost, Even by today's standards, where we have, Enfant Terrible who built at a young age, but in the 19th century, to build so much and so well, often by 48 is quite something. And this is still functioning, very well. These are recent pictures. A memorial, Montgomery, 1876, no picture, library, also memorial library, also in Massachusetts. This is the plan. We know by now a building by Louis, by H Richardson, of course. This is by him, no question about it. I think he was more inspired than Frank Lloyd Wright in the choice of his roofing tiles. I don't know, the buildings by Wright, excellent as they are, very often they use a tile for the roof, which in my opinion is not matching the quality of everything else. They use this, maybe my perception is colored by my youth in Sibiu, where, all the ceramic tiles for the sloping roofs were the rule, but in the buildings by Wright, at least here the color, I don't know exactly what kind of tiles or material he uses, but at least the color, in my opinion, is better chosen than in some buildings and not a few by Wright as the material for the roof. Yes, his architecture maybe is not very spectacular, very surprising, but you cannot deny its virtues. And I would say an appreciable amount, if I can use this sort of dignity. Would one read a book with pleasure? Yeah, I would say so. It's a library and it's probably quiet and this atmosphere of history and solid walls and arches and so on. I think it's conducive to study. Another library, also in Massachusetts. Not very dissimilar from what we already saw, but again, a robust, satisfying building. I'm just amazed at how much he built in a relatively short time. sorry about this. But the interior looks very impressive, you know, and reminds me of the curved ceiling, the top of the building, the own building of Frank Lloyd Wright at Oak Park, his studio. What can I say? Again, you know, if this building was built, recently, it would still have, would provoke a lot of interest, I would say. The interior, I was talking about the interior. Now, if you build a building looking like this one today from the outside, well, it would be considered, not obsolete maybe, but dangerously associated with what we call historicism. Sever Hall in Cambridge, a Richardson building, difficult to attribute to someone else. We kind of know by now, he uses rectangular, schemes, but then he introduces towers or other curved rooms, and there is a love affair with Romanesque architecture and with a certain European tradition, but because of the windows, you see the windows are rather many and rather large. So I would say this is a gesture of a certain modernity. Not an alarming modernity, but still modernity. It's not a, his architecture is not a whimsical architecture. It's not whimsical. It's rather rational. It's balanced. It's heavy. It's to be trusted, probably like the man himself. Much can be done with bricks, that's for sure. A town hall, Northeastern in Massachusetts, not very different actually from a library or the last library we saw. Yes, another Richardson building with the, predictably by now, long nave almost, a nave inside the building, and then a few vertical accents, so to speak. In this case, there is also this more emphatic large room on the second floor. So it's a city hall, it's not a library. But otherwise, the buildings are not very different actually from each other. Lots of stone. He loved the arch. That's clear. I don't think he built any building without an arch, at least not the public buildings. Just imagine how many drawings this man had to draw. I'm sure he had collaborators, but you know, considering the amount of works he did in a short time, it's not a little thing. The rectory of the Trinity Church, so this is a building, I guess, not far away from the Trinity Church that we already saw, a good building itself. And somehow these buildings from the 19th century to me seem to be more, even more valuable now, you know, after so much sterility and modern thinness and glass. Here you have these buildings which, again, you can trust. It's like old money as opposed to new money. This is old money. Look at this entrance, you know, power, you know. You enter this building through you probably feel like someone who deserves some attention and some respect when you enter through such an entrance here. It's so different now from entering from a basement where you park your car and you take an elevator here. No, the transition between the street and the building is done in an emphatic way and encouraging to harbor feelings which are not of are not so to succumb in inferiority complexes. Okay, this monument I like, 1879 from Wyoming. Look at this, you know, it's, regardless of the anecdotal details, but it's primal, it's archaic, it's surprising, you know, because this was a man immersed in the European culture. But here is something else. It's, of course, the Egyptian, influence can be seen. It's a, of course, it's not a pyramid for a pharaoh, but the, you know, the spirit of the work is somehow surprising, considering we saw another work in a cemetery he did before. This is very different. Look at this, you know, it's, so the man was not actually stuck into a signature way of doing things. He was also experimenting. Now, who the beneficiary was, meaning the person who is buried there, I don't know, but the building itself, you know, especially in this picture, you will say, wow, you know, this is a new pyramid or trunk of a pyramid discovered recently in Egypt. Well, it's not. It's, let's see again where it is. In Wyoming, in the States, 1879. So he was able to surprise sometimes, maybe even himself. Interesting. A gate lodge in the same place. No, this is in Massachusetts, that, but for the same person, it seems, or from the same family. Here also we'll see some big stones. I mean, look at them. You know, I imagine it wasn't him who was handling these big stones. He just gave indications to the workers. And I see here even the eyes of the city, as they are called in Sibiu. Not very common in the North American architectural landscape, but I see he employed them. H. Richardson, the big stones of H. Richardson. I remember now the words of Lina Bovardi, who loves stones. And she has an essay, you know, where she talks about stones and diamonds. And she advocates the cause of the stones in contrast with the diamonds. I too believe that somehow stones are more precious than diamonds. Yeah, the so-called banal stones. Those greatness we think is just a sign of banality, but it's not. Now, it's true, you know, to bring all those stones from who knows where here was some effort in the 19th century. A bridge, 1880 in Massachusetts. We're approaching the end of the presentation. Good bridge, you know, again, solid, to be trusted building construction by H Richardson. This kind of bridge, you don't have the fear that it will melt down underneath your feet or underneath your car. No, it's meant to last. Stony Brook Gatehouse, Boston, 1880, a little house, not so impressive. Another public library in Quincy, Massachusetts, no pictures. And now the old Colony railroad station. He built a few few railway stations inspired by Japanese culture or not. At that time, the United States was developing rapidly an extensive network of railways. Railways, it doesn't believe in any longer. In the United States, the trains are a shame. You know, they are so obsolete and so slow, and the design is so, you know, retrograde. It's unbelievable that the same country which, you know, where in the 19th century, the train was so important, but this was before the arrival of the T model by Henry Ford, about whom I talked the other day. Its Majesty the car dethroned the train, and I travel by train. Only the poorest people in the United States travel by train. From New York to Denver, Colorado, it took me 48 hours, 2 days and two nights. Can you believe it? Well, with a stop in Chicago and changing the train, but still. They do not belong to the 21st century, that's for sure. Anyway, we saw these details. I don't know if it's really Japanese, maybe Polynesian or something. Anyway, but trains are nice, and so are the railway stations, I think, conceptually, so to speak. Another library. Do I have pictures? I do. It's a massive fortress of knowledge, a typical Richardson building. It could have been something else too, very close, maybe a city hall or even a church. It's a library. Very interesting space here, though. I didn't find more recent pictures, but this old picture is intriguing enough, more than intriguing. I like what I see. Another church, 1883 in Pennsylvania. Simple, but I would say eloquent. Yes, I would say that there is a certain level, maybe increasing level of modernity. Not the modernity we are accustomed with from the early 20th century, but there is something here, you know, in the simplicity of the volume and this quest for simplicity, I think is rather modern. He didn't indulge in weakening the building with a lot of details and ornaments and so on. These buildings are interesting. I mean, look at this. You know, this is a massive architecture, and these buildings would mean a lot to any city in the world. So these were done in Pittsburgh, 1883. So, you know, almost 150 years ago. It's a county, you know, county building. And what can we say? Compare this building with these buildings here. There is this massive, this massivity is, I think, impressive and maybe needed again in architecture. I prepared a PowerPoint presentation called Citadels. And I think the aesthetics and also the functions of a citadel might return. I am attracted by citadels, it's true. And here we look at these massive walls. You know, you almost say this cannot be in the United States. It has to be somewhere else. But it is in the United States, in Pittsburgh. And the interiors, well, you can find pictures with people getting married here. Maybe I even have a picture myself with something like this. It's massive. And the space is, has a certain level of fluidity. It has a certain level of complexity. Yes, he doesn't renounce easily to the arch. It's true, but I think he's not mimicking here something he cannot honor. Yes, here they are, the married couple, and it's very possible that this location for such important events in the life of a couple, this architectonic background is desired. Maybe because this building expresses exactly it's something, this building evokes longevity. And this is what a marriage needs, longevity, because so many end up in divorce. So by uniting yourself with someone else under inside this architecture, could maybe mean that, yeah, the marriage will be a long-lasting one, and hopefully trust will exist forever, and so on. So architecture is, whatever Peter Zumthor might say, you know, it's not that it is saving the world, but it is contributing to the world in either good ways or bad ways. It's not leaving no trace on life, architecture. Look at these massive walls. I think they are remarkable. It's a fortress, it's a citadel inside the city of Pittsburgh. who would have expected such an architecture in a North American city? Well, surprise, surprise. That's it, I think, yes. So happy birthday, Henry Hobson Richardson. Maybe next year we'll make a more ample, a more developed presentation.